George Galloway's 22% in the Batley and Spen by-election was not a bad result for a political outsider. However, it wasn't enough to achieve his goal of beating Labour, which he was very confident he would do just 2 weeks ago.
Let me break it to you gently. Labour are going to be third in this by-election.
Oh, they actually, to say that decisively now, that 100% Labour are coming
100%.
Third.
100%. I'll eat my hat in
your
presence.
Would you actually eat your hat?
I'll eat my hat if they're not third.
Now, George Galloway hasn't taken the result very well. And this morning he went out in front of the TV cameras and he didn't eat his hat. Of course, it was George Galloway who came third, not the Labour Party. Instead of eating his headwear, he announced he will dispute the election result.
On multiple grounds, we will apply to the courts for this election result to be set aside. You'll be hearing much more of this from me directly from the horse's mouth over the next hours and days.
Now, I have to admit, I have no idea what that challenge is going to be on the basis on. We'll talk about Galloway's campaign a bit, but first of all, Aaron, do you have any idea what that challenge is going to be based on?
Yeah, there's a few things. So the majority for the Labour Party is 323. As I understand it, the Tories asked for a recount, a full recount. They didn't get it. This is what I'm told by Galloway's election agent. And that is highly irregular. So they're disputing that. And also Galloway's, they're claiming that on election day, Galloway's campaign literature was ripped down by the council. Again, this is what I'm told by the election agent. They're disputing that. that isn't being denied by the council. The council said that it contravened certain regulations with regards to the size of the lettering. Sounds very strange. I mean, ultimately, I don't think it meant Kim Ledbetter won. But you know, I mean, if that's an issue, they should, you know, obviously feel free to raise it. Any party should. So that's it, really. It was the count, and then it was the posters. Excuse me, on the final days, and then finally, actually, they also had a mail out, which they used through Royal Mail, a leaflet mail out, which was never delivered, and they're claiming sort of issues there with the Royal Mail. But there are a few incidents where they feel like they were impeded. Oh, and also at the start of the campaign, they were given corrupted data in terms of electoral rolls and so on. Again, I don't know if any of this is true. This is just what I'm being relayed by the election agent for George Galloway.
I mean, none of it also sounds significant enough to just overturn the election result. Because also, I mean, George Galloway got 22%. It wasn't particularly close to winning. So all of those would have had to have, led to, without those supposed impediments, getting 5,000 extra votes. So it does seem a bit like sour grapes going in front of the TV cameras and saying, we're going to dispute the election results. So it has to happen all over again. Obviously, it was a close election between Labour and the Tories. It wasn't a close election between George Galloway and anyone.
I mean, I suppose they would argue, well, if we got an extra however many votes from Labour, then, you know, and we're talking in the hundreds then we would have won. I mean, I agree with you, Michael. I think it's important to say if any party has an issue with an election, you know, I feel Al Gore in 2000 should have contested the decisions made around that election. I think some very strange things, improper things happened. I agree with you. I think if, on the other hand, it was the Tory candidate saying all this and it was this close, yeah, okay, that would make a bit more sense. However, it does sound like there are some things that, you know, they are substantial. They're not completely fictitious, but it doesn't sound like they were anywhere near enough to be enough. And in terms of the full recount, I mean, there were certain tranches of ballots which were checked over and over again. A full recount, my God, Michael, you know, we got the result at 6 a.m. I think if they'd done a full recount, we would have had to wait till, God, 1, 2 in the afternoon. And look, if it's 50, 60 votes, okay. You know, like one of the Southampton seats in 2017, 300 votes. I mean, again, the Tory candidate was entitled to contest that, and apparently they did. So it's not just Galloway that has some issues here. But I think in all likelihood, it's going nowhere, yes.
What's your assessment of Galloway's campaign in general? Obviously, lots has been said about it, mainly negative, especially in the last week, people pointing at Galloway and saying that's one of the reasons the campaign was as divisive as it was. I mean, what's your take there?
I think for anybody to come from nowhere, not even be acquainted with the constituency, and to get more than 20% is remarkable. I think he knew he would get that. And I think that's why he said he would eat his hat if Labour didn't win. I think everybody thought if he gets 20%, Labour lose. I mean, the poll that was by Servation, the only real notable poll, had him on 6%. And even that was enough for Labour to lose by 6%. So you look at that and then you look at the final results. I mean, it is a miracle. So even, you know, this is the strange thing about Batley and Spen. You've got people arguing both sides. it's a terrible result for Labour. It's a fantastic result for Labour. It's a bit of both, you know, within the broader context. It is a terrible result for Labour. They shouldn't be in this position. On the other hand, if you look at all the sort of the dynamic factors in play locally in the final week, it was completely unexpected. I think Galloway, from what he told me, I interviewed him, I wrote a piece for NovaraMedia.com, that they plan to stand again and again and again in these kinds of seats. And, you know, in Batley and Spen, it wasn't enough. But if he had a seat turn up again like Bradford West with a larger Muslim population, I think Labour would have a problem. And Batley and Spen, you know, it was being sort of presented as a Bradford West, but it wasn't. You know, Batley East, for instance, has a very high Muslim population, but it's still only, I think, 25% of the overall population of the constituency was Muslim. It's a primarily white constituency. And it's a very complex constituency. You had people that were moved by Brexit. You had ex-Labour voters tempted by the Tories. You had Muslim voters turned off by Keir Starmer. You had Labour voters who don't like the local Labour council. And so I think given all that, I think he navigated a lot of those issues really expertly. I mean, he's clearly a very talented politician. And I'm sure this will be clipped up and they'll be taken out of context. But clearly, you don't win a by-election in Bradford West as a respect candidate if you're not good at politics in 2012. You don't win an election in Bowen Bethnal Green as a respect candidate in 2005. You know, he won twice as effectively a third-party candidate. And, you know, he came third here. And he came second in Bradford West, it should be said, in 2015 when he was up for re-election. So he has a really strong record. He's clearly very good at what he does. I think they'll be gutted that they didn't make the difference and stop Labour winning. I think they'll be absolutely gutted. And I think they genuinely thought they could do that. However, I think they'll try and do it again. I mean, if anything, maybe this will strengthen his resolve. I don't know. I mean, you know, he has a nice life. He has a TV show. He has a nice holiday home. He has a wife, children. I mean, I personally would retire from politics, but it seems that he's not going away anytime soon.